Okay, good morning. I thought I had opened this for discussion, but Wednesday is going to be again a Monday timetable. But I had already arranged a meeting, thinking that it's a holiday. At 9 o'clock, I have to go for a meeting. So I think it's impossible for me to take Monday's class. But fortunately, I had taken one extra. So hopefully, we'll not miss out on. So I was thinking the 27th is a working day and I'll be missing that class. So anyway, I had taken one. So hopefully, it's not a major issue. But before we open for discussion, I was thinking that I'll talk just a little bit about DC motor drive control, because that's a typical problem which can come up when we look at either fully controlled converter or semi-controlled converter from single phase or three phase side. I'll just tell you basically how we calculate the speed torque characteristics for a DC motor when it is fed by a fully controlled or semi-controlled converter, and then I'll open it for discussion. Is that all right? So I would mainly talk about separately excited, because I don't want the field also to get modified. So separately excited, I'll be able to keep the field completely separate and the armature completely separate. The two controls can be completely decoupled from each other. So separately excited DC motor fed by a rectifier. So we are looking at, let us say, a fully controlled single phase converter. I'm just taking the single phase converter. Three phase would almost work similarly. And then I'm going to have the DC motor drive here. Right? Yes, guys, please settle down. Lot of crosstalk. Please stop talking, thank you. So this is going to be my supply. And let me assume maybe this is positive and this is negative during positive half cycle. And I'm going to have a field which is excited by a constant excitation current, IF. So the flux is not going to change at all, right? So what I get as EB will be proportional to the speed, because the field current is a constant, right? So I will have this as plus and this as minus, right? Normally the rating of the DC motor drive will be given, maybe 220 volts, 10 ampere, you know, whatever is the output, vagera, vagera, all the details will be given, because of which you should be able to calculate the back EMF constant. Back EMF constant calculation is not a big deal, right? So if I am given, for example, 220 volts, 10 ampere, maybe 1000 RPM, right? DC motor drive with maybe RA value is also given. So with all that, you should be, let us say RA is 1 ohm, for example. So you should be able to write whatever is the output. It's not a big deal, because you are going to write basically 220 multiplied by 10 minus 10, that is, this is IARA, will be equal to 210 volts, which is the EB rated. And if 1000 RPM is your rated speed, you can always calculate what is the back EMF. And if I know 210 volts is the EB multiplied by IA will give me the power that is developed internally, and then you might have to subtract the mechanical losses. So you are just recalling 203. So that is how you would be doing the whole thing. Right. If I want to run it at the rated speed, maybe I will have to apply 220 volts. If I want to run it at any other speed, then how do I calculate the voltage to be applied and the firing angle? That's all is the matter with fully controlled rectifier. So if I say that my back EMF constant happens to be, that is KE happens to be 210 divided by 104.72 radians per second. I'm converting 1000 RPM into radians per second. So this is volt second per radians. Right? So if I have a back EMF constant, and if you are given what is the AC supply, maybe AC supply is 230 volts, right? So if you are given 230 volts, 50 hertz supply, or 240 volts, 50 hertz supply, whatever, right? Then you should be able to calculate what is the firing angle if a speed of 700 RPM is to be achieved at 50% load torque, then alpha equal to what? This is the kind of question typically you may be able to, you know, calculate for. So in this case, if it is 50% load torque, hopefully neglecting the no load current, I can say roughly the current is 5 ampere. 10 ampere corresponds to 100% load torque. 50% load torque is always proportional to field current and armature current. Field current I'm keeping as a constant. I'm not touching the field current at all. So if I want 50% of the load torque, I should have basically 5 ampere. So I should be able to say at 50% load torque, IA equal to 5 ampere. RA anyway is 1 ohm, that is given. Right? 700 RPM, at 700 RPM, I should be able to calculate what is EB. You guys know how to calculate it. Whatever is the back EMF at 1000 RPM, which was 210, you can multiply that by 700 and divide by 1000. So you should be able to get that value, right? At a constant excitation, everything is at constant excitation. So I'm going to get this as the back EMF. Once I have the back EMF, all I need to do is to add IARA drop. That will give me the terminal voltage. So I should say at this operating point, terminal voltage will be equal to EB 700 plus IA dash RA. Let me call this as IA dash. IA dash is 5 ampere. So I should be able to calculate exactly what is the value of terminal voltage. And this terminal voltage, if I say it is fully controlled converter, I should be able to write this as 2Vm by pi cos alpha, provided, what is the condition? 2Vm by pi cos alpha, is it valid all the time? Yes. For a fully controlled converter without freewheeling diode, 2Vm by pi cos alpha expression is valid only when? Yes? Come on. You guys have listened to fully controlled converter for so long. Tell me. At what point this particular expression is valid? You integrated from alpha to pi plus alpha. That is when you got this expression. What does it mean? Continuous conduction. Thank you. That is continuous conduction. Only if the conduction is continuous, this particular expression is valid. So if I don't give continuous conduction, you can always say the question is ambiguous. So unless I say it is continuous conduction, if it is, whether it is continuous conduction or discontinuous conduction, if I say there is a freewheeling diode, then at least you can say it is integrated from alpha to pi, right? So if I am talking about fully controlled converter without a freewheeling diode, I have to specifically say it is continuous conduction. So I should say, assuming continuous IA. I have to say, I am assuming continuous armature current through the DC motor. Otherwise, it is not going to really make any sense to use this particular expression. This expression is not valid if there is discontinuity. I have to know where the beta value is, and then I can integrate only from alpha to beta. So it is not really correct to apply this expression for anything else. So if I am given a firing angle with continuous conduction, I should be able to decide the operating point and vice versa. If I am given a speed and torque, I should be able to definitely get what is the value of firing angle if, you know, I am knowing the motor parameters. I should know the motor parameters. If I don't know the motor parameters, I would not be able to do anything, obviously. So I should know what is the RA value, what is the kind of back EMF constant it has, and so on and so forth. Only then I should be able to get this whole thing, right? Is this clear? This is a typical DC motor drive control problem. You should be able to do the same thing for three phase as well. For three phase, only thing is this expression, whatever we have got here, will be replaced by 3Vm by pi cos alpha, where Vm is line peak again, right? If I give a semi-control converter for three phase, of course, I have not still done. Single phase, you have to change the expression. That's all is the difference, right? And you guys should know how to draw the waveforms also for these cases. I don't think it's a big deal now that you have known all the rectifiers, right? Only thing is, we have not talked still about when alpha becomes greater than 90, which hopefully I will take up, because I hope so that you will have questions. If not, we can discuss that. If you have questions, we'll discuss the questions what you have. If not, we'll have to look at what happens when in the same motor drive, if I make alpha greater than 90 or the speed becomes greater than whatever is supposed to be its no load speed. What happens? We can discuss it a little later. Yes, guys. Now, whatever questions, is this understood? Is this clear? Any questions on this? If I ask for discontinuous conduction, it will be a very, very long procedure. So, in all probability, I will not be able to ask discontinuous conduction. Not in all probability. 99.99%. I cannot ask discontinuous conduction. Right? Yes. So, what are the questions that you have? Any waveforms, anything you want me to redraw? So you say that this is regarding characteristics of which device? I have to recall also, because I have now uploaded so many of them, I don't even know. Otherwise, you do one thing. Otherwise, you come back to me. Because if I have to post it on Moodle, I'll do that. Any questions you have, please send me an email. I'll still respond. It's not a problem. And in fact, it may be more worthwhile if you send it to me by email, because it has a documentation. I'll put it up in the Moodle. Whoever sends the question, I will try to get it solved, or I'll solve it myself and put it up. By the way, Wednesday, I should be available in my office after, say, 11 o'clock, because I have a meeting at 9. So it may go on for about one and a half hours. So I will not be taking the class for people who came late. Although it's a Monday timetable, I will not be taking the class on Wednesday, but I'll be available very much in my office. Not a problem. And I think your exam is on Friday. I don't think I know the timing as yet. 11 o'clock? Sure? God, we have a seminar anyway. Okay, come on. Yes. feedback diode for an inverter. For an inverter. Okay. Okay, so what is the application of a feedback diode in an inverter? How does it function? That is the question Gantavya was asking. So let us first of all look at the inverter circuit. I'm going to show it with an IGBT, right? So this is one, and I'm going to have a load connected here. No talking, please. Thank you. So we are going to have one more device like this. Let me call this as one and this as one dash. And similarly, when I want the current in this direction, this is the way it is. And when I want the current in the opposite direction, I'm going to have one device like this and one more device like this. So this is two and this is two dash. And I'm going to have the current somewhat like this. I'm going to complete the circuit now. So this is how it is as far as an inverter is concerned. When I want to convert DC to AC. So this is the DC supply. Let me call this point as A, this point as B, this point as C, this point as D. So when 1 and 1 dash are conducting, I'm going to have from A through 1, through C, D, and then through 1 dash back to the DC supply. That's how it is going to be. And when 2 and 2 dash are conducting, it will be just the opposite. So let me first of all draw the kind of waveform that we are going to get when 1 and 1 dash are conducting. I am drawing basically the load voltage. So I am saying V, C, D. That's what I am drawing. What is the voltage across CD I'm drawing? So when 1 and 1 dash are conducting, I'm going to have, if I say this is VDC, I'm going to have VDC coming up right across CD because I'm assuming that the other two devices are ideal. They are not having any drop. So I'm going to assume that it is going to be somewhat like this. And then after that, I'm going to have a voltage which is somewhat like this. So this should be plus VDC and this should be minus VDC. This is the way the voltage will be. If I have a resistance load, I will have the current exactly following the voltage. There is no difference whatsoever. Because of which, I will have essentially 1 and 1 dash exactly stopping the conduction at this point. If I may call this a 0, pi and 2 pi because I am converting them into AC voltage. So this is how it is going to be. But if I am going to have an RL load, inductive load, right, R and L, then maybe the current would have started from some value. I don't know. I'll have to check. But even initially, if I talk about when the circuit was dead, the current would have increased until this pi because L di by dt equal to V minus Ri. That is the way it will be. Depending upon what is V minus Ri value, I'm going to have definitely, you know, the current increasing further and further. Anyway, the inductance would have built up some energy. So I would have actually maybe the current going somewhat like this. It would have increased until here. But the current cannot come down abruptly to zero. If I switch off 1 and 1 dash, if there is no other path available for the current, because the current is flowing in this direction, it can flow only through these two devices. If I turn them off, if I remove the gate pulses, both of them are going to turn themselves off right away. This is having inductance. If I try to bring down the current to zero, di by dt is literally infinity. Even if I is only 2 ampere, dt is literally close to zero. So I will have di by dt because of the denominator being very, very small, it will reach infinity. If it reaches infinite value, this open circuit voltage here will be enormously high, which means I'm going to have both these devices facing the brunt of the inductance stored energy abruptly trying to collapse. So these two devices will immediately conk out. If I try to put a circuit like this with RL load, and if I try to turn off immediately the inductance load current, then I'm going to see that these two devices can conk out. So to avoid that, I might like to put a diode called a feedback diode, which will come exactly in anti-parallel for each of these. So these are all called feedback diode, which come in anti-parallel. Now the current had been flowing like this. Now if you look at this, this diode, right, and this diode, they are, you know, conducive for the conduction in the same direction. But only thing is that, please note that this voltage source is connected exactly in the opposite direction to that of how it was connected with 1 and 1 dash. Because if you now look at the path is going to be somewhat like this. It's the same current, all right, but this current is going to go like this, and it is going to get into the positive of this particular battery. Please note, this is completing the path using this diode. So you can see that the current flows again in the same direction. But if you look at it from the battery's viewpoint, the battery is not supplying it anymore. It is rather taking the energy which was stored in the inductance. Right? So if you look at it, this positive now is connected to D through the diode, and this negative is connected to C again through the diode. So there is a reversal of polarity as far as the load voltage is concerned. So the load voltage will still be negative when feedback diodes conduct, but the current here is going to start coming down. How fast or how slowly it comes down depends upon what is the kind of source voltage I have had, and what is the kind of RI drop I have had, and what is the kind of inductance value I have had in comparison to the resistance. All these things dictate how much of energy would have been stored in the inductance. So I am going to have this. Now the negative voltage is applied, so it will obviously start increasing in the opposite direction. And again it will start, you know, this will be the kind of current waveform, exponential rise and exponential fall. That's what you would see normally in the inverter circuit, in an RL circuit basically. So I should say, if you talk about the devices that conduct from here to here, it will be 1 1 dash, whereas from here to here, if I may call this as D2 and this as D2 dash, this will be D2 and D2 dash. And from here to here, right, I should have had the other two devices, that is 2 and 2 dash until here. And here the corresponding D1 and D1 dash. So obviously this current should have started somewhere from the negative side. Although I have shown it as though it has started from positive, it should have started from the negative side, because that current must have been inverting its polarity. It was flowing like this and then it is going like this. So I should have drawn a replica here too. So here I should correct it as though it is starting from somewhere here, something like this. Not this one. This is not correct. Right? Yeah. Inductance stored energy will make sure of that. If inductance energy had not been there, I don't have really the requirement of the presence of the diodes at all. The inductance is basically making sure that the current continues in the same direction. When it is making sure that the current is continuing in the same direction, automatically di by dt is in the opposite sense, because of which you will have a reversal of polarity of the voltage. The moment you have a reversal of polarity of the voltage, the diodes will automatically make, you know, take advantage of that. That's how it is. So how long this current continues in that direction itself? It is continuing from here to here. That duration is dependent upon how much of inductance energy stored is there. How much of energy is stored. And that is going to forward bias the diode. That energy, as long as it exists, it will forward bias the diode. The moment it is not sustainable, the diodes will be reverse biased, the current will come down to zero. So all of them happen naturally because of the energy stored and the energy is given back to the battery. Then it is as good as our load. If you say that the inductance is negligibly small, that even before switching, you know, it is just giving away its energy, it doesn't have, that means it is as good as our load. In our load, you don't have to have the feedback diode. But most of our circuits will contain at least some minimum inductance. Because even the copper wires, thick copper wires, have some inductance. Just can't help it. So there is nothing like a pure resistive load, except for maybe a few that you can mention as example for pure resistive load is your incandescent lamps. Many of them are purely resistive, hardly any inductance. If you look at our heater, what we have at home during winter, those things are our immersion rods. Most of them are having negligible inductance. Those are the typical examples of pure resistance. Yes. I hope this is clear. Any further questions on this? Purely inductive has to essentially, probably it has to go maybe all the way, which is again hypothetical. There is nothing like pure inductance. That's why the question I asked in the quiz is hypothetical. There is nothing like pure inductance. Any copper wire will also have a resistance. It is hypothetical, clearly. Okay? So if it is pure inductance, I'm going to have essentially L di by dt equal to V dc. Right? This is how it is going to be. So the current would have increased further and further until here. Maybe. Right? And during negative, if I assume that I'm going to have the same negative value here, it would have probably given back all the energy until here. So the diodes will, always the current will be positive. I am assuming pure inductance. Then in all probability, always the current would have been positive, provided I started off with a positive half cycle. If I had started off with a negative half cycle, always the current will be negative. Right? Hypothetical. Yes. Completely hypothetical. You get my point? So it's not an inverter anymore. Voltage is alternating. The current is not alternating. You mean to say that if it is starting from here? Yes, it must have increased until here. And then it must have, yes. It would have been something similar, but with maybe same frequency as the supply voltage. What he is asking is, if rather than assuming that I am starting from the beginning, zero, if I had started with pi by 2, so what will happen? So if I do like this, maybe the current would have gone like this, then it would have come down like this, again increased, decreased, and so on. These things are interesting questions to handle using PSIM. Maybe You guys can try these things. It is really worth looking at those things if you, you know, just want to check how the whole thing functions. Right? Yes. You guys all have done 203 with me, so you know that it will not be just numericals. No way I will ask only numericals. You guys know it. So there will be some reasoning. There will be some waveforms. All those things will be asked. Huh, if I ask for any numerical, I would like you guys to derive. So either I'll give you a formula sheet. Right? So far, not too many formulas have come, but still, I'll give you a formula sheet, so you don't have to worry about memorizing any expression. I repeat it. You don't have to memorize any expression, not at all. Right? Any expression that is required, I'll give it. Or I'll ask you to derive it then and there, for which I will allocate some marks. You're talking about even here, when the current is, huh? No, at pi by 2, I have started the firing of 1 and 1 dash. See, you can imagine that still my frequency is actually from 0 to pi and pi to 2 pi, no doubt. 0 to pi, we are supposed to fire 1 and 1 dash. But it so happens that my computer or microprocessor or whatever, it is starting at this point. Arbitrarily, it has started from pi by 2. So, the current has increased until I had 1 and 1 dash fired, right? And it is pure inductance. So, until then, the current would have increased continuously. After that, I have fired 2 and 2 dash. So, 1 and 1 dash will cease to conduct. I will remove the pulses from 1 and 1 dash and give it to 2 and 2 dash. In an inverter, never ever will we fire the two devices in the same leg. Never ever. If we try to do that, then this will be a dead shot. It will be called shoot through condition. Shoot through is deadly. So we cannot have pulses going to 1 as well as 2 dash. Similarly, 2 as well as 1 dash. I cannot have pulses going simultaneously. So the moment I fire 2 and 2 dash, 1 and 1 dash anyway have stopped conducting. Now the inductance will take over. So inductance is trying to feed back the energy through the diodes. When it is feeding back the energy through the diodes, we said that this positive is connected here and this negative is connected here. So the voltage of the load has completely gone inverted. That's the reason why we are seeing a negative voltage. Right? And once the current reaches, you know, if it reaches zero, then obviously I will not have these two diodes conducting. Rather, these two devices, the other two devices will start conducting, 2 and 2 dash. So in this particular case, I had to show as though 1 and 1 dash conduct here. And I'm going to have D2 and D2 dash conducting here. Right? And after that, 2 and 2 dash will conduct for this duration and so on. When I have both voltage and current as positive, the power is flowing from DC side to AC side. When I have maybe one of them as positive and one of them as negative, the power is flowing the other way around from the load into the battery. You get my point? And if I am having both of them to be negative during this duration, I will have the battery supplying the power to the load. And when I have one of them positive, the other one voltage negative, then I'm going to have again the power going, you know, in the reverse direction. That is how it will be. So you have to see that, you know, if both of them are actually in the same polarity, then the power is actually getting converted into AC. Otherwise, it's as though the load is feeding back to the mains, the battery. So the power direction can change. No, you mean to say that, just a second, protection of, rather series connection of diodes. So you have one diode here, one more diode here, and their leakage currents are different. Their leakage currents are different, and they have to block a voltage. This is plus and this is minus. So they are blocking a large voltage. And normally we put something like this. Two resistances we put in parallel. So you mean to say that only one resistance will do the job? That is, in this normally we, what we write is that if I say this is VD1 and this is VD2 and this is the total current I should rather show it the other way around, because leakage, it is the opposite direction. So this is the I leakage, total. So I'm going to have essentially VD1 divided by R1 plus whatever is the I leakage of 1, right, equal to VD2 divided by R2 plus what is I leakage of 2, together will be I leakage as such, right? So if you are saying that, let us use only one resistance such that these two are equated. That's what you are trying to say, right? See, only thing is, it depends upon whether you want to have even minor discrepancy between VD1 and VD2. I would like you guys to do this exercise. You say that maybe both of them have to block a voltage of 10 kilovolts, right? And each of them is maybe rated for 6 kilovolts. Each is rated for 6 kilovolts. If I don't mind having a discrepancy of 1 kilovolts between the two blocking voltages, that is one case. And if I mind actually having any discrepancy at all, so in for both cases you try to calculate and see which case has a higher copper loss. Definitely there will be copper losses. Please check how the copper losses will be. If I want exactly 5 kilovolts division among both the diodes, that is one case. The other case is maybe one can have 5.5, the other one can have 4.5. You also take one of the examples from Rashid and see leakage current difference. Maybe one has, you know, a few milliamperes, maybe 20 milliamperes, the other one has 30 milliamperes or something. Yeah. I had put this up in Moodle. Please look through. If you have not looked through, Apoor, I don't expect this of you. Please look this up. And there are at least 3 such solved examples given in the diode chapter of Rashid. I want you guys to look at the textbook. Please do read the textbook. Please do. Don't depend only on the notes. You want to look at what Rashid has to say, apart from what Bhuvaneswari has said. Please. For heaven's sake, please take a look. I'm not saying whatever the book gives is the gospel, but I think you should read a book. It's important. Any book. I'm not saying only Rashid, any other book. Doesn't matter. Right? So I feel that if you choose only one resistance, the copper losses could be much more. Maybe you try to calculate. please try to calculate and check it up. I feel that it may be much more, but this is the standard practice that's very commonly used in HVDC systems and so on. Because in HVDC transmission, we normally use 84 to 100 series SCRs. One device will correspond to about 84 to 100 series SCRs. That's how it is. Yes, guys. Have you read already from the book? No? Yeah, but I told you that just don't take Bhuvaneswari for granted, right? You should look at something else. Told you that. See, SCR characteristics is very, very similar to diode characteristics, except that by giving a gate pulse only, it is going to start conducting. But beyond a particular forward voltage, it will break down. Breakover voltage. So if you try to apply beyond this value, let us say it is rated for 10 kilovolts, 7 kilovolts. So maybe that is 7 kilovolts. If you try to go beyond that, it will be a destructive breakdown. It will not be able to come back to normalcy. So you are going to see that this is the forward breakover voltage. And similarly, I will have a reverse breakdown voltage, right? So I would be seeing that the device will break down in a destructive manner if I try to apply beyond that whatever is the rated voltage of that particular device. So in the reverse direction, if I draw, literally the current would be very, very small leakage current, and then suddenly once you cross this, it has to increase quite a bit in the reverse direction. So that is like a destructive breakdown. And in the forward direction, even before the breakover voltage, if I actually try to apply a gate pulse, the moment the gate pulse comes, there will be a very, very short negative resistance kind of region, which is transient, which you will not be able to operate the device continuously in that region. And after that, you would see that it is really following something like a diode's characteristics, forward, regular resistance, whatever is the forward resistance multiplied by the current will be the voltage, that kind of characteristic. So this is going to be I and this is going to be V. So this is VFBO, VRBD. And if I give the gate bias with the higher intensity, right? So this is with the higher intensity. If I have only a lower intensity, then it will take more amount of gate current. Only if I have more gate current, at that point, it is going to probably start conducting. So if I look at actually the voltage that I have applied, whatever is the voltage applied, when it is very, very minimal, I will require a large amount of gate drive. If the voltage is somewhat higher, then I require only a lower amount of gate drive for the device to latch into conduction. It will require only less amount of gate drive. So this is going to be the different types of, but ultimately they all coincide. The moment it starts and latches into conduction, the characteristics are the same. But when I'm applying a very, very small value of voltage, at that point, I might require a little bit more of the gate drive to latch the device into conduction. So actually, these characteristics are not so much of importance for us, especially in power electronics, because most of the times we talk about 230 volts or 440 volts, compared to which the forward drop or anything is very, very small. And thyristors generally take a little longer to get into conduction and turn off also. Both takes longer. Because of that, 20 millisecond is still pretty small duration. It's not a very long duration. But if you are talking about something like MOSFET or IGBT, then yes, we have to worry about even the small duration from where it is rising from 0 to 5 volts or 3 volts or 4 volts. But in thyristor, we don't have to worry so much. Yeah, yeah, it will go all the way, and once it breaks down again, the resistance is going to be small. But it is gone, that's it. It may not respond to turning off at all. It is as good as you have short-circuited the device. If I think it will lose control. To be honest, I have never seen a thyristor break down so easily. Normally, MTBF, mean time between failure for thyristor, they say is infinity, literally. Mean time between failures for SCRs, thyristors, very difficult to break them, like induction motors. They'll not break down so easily. You have to really manhandle them. Then they'll break down. Otherwise, generally, SCRs are very rugged, extremely rugged. At least that's what I have seen. I have worked with thyristor for my PhD project, MTech project, maybe for BTech project as well, all three, yes. So, they are very rugged. Yes. Beta 1 plus beta 2 plus beta 1, beta 2. No. Beta 1 plus beta 2 plus beta 1, beta 2. I think I have put the derivation also there. Take a look. Otherwise, I am very sure it is there in Daniel Hart or... even Rashid. Rashid has this derivation. Please take a look. See, basically, Darlington pair, you are going to connect the collectors together, right? So this is, both collectors are connected together, and this emitter is going to feed into the base of the next transistor. This is how it is, right? So this is going to be the normal connection. This is how it is. This is Darlington pair. So the emitter current is the collector current plus base current. That is the reason. You don't say emitter current is equal to collector current. It is not. This emitter current is equal to collector current plus base current. So I will have this collector current equal to beta 1 times the base current of this particular transistor. So obviously this base current will become collector current is beta times, this emitter current is going to be beta 1 times IB plus IB. So that is the reason you will get beta 1 plus beta 2 plus beta 1, beta 2. I'm sure you will get that, right? No. So that is the reason. So this will be equal to IC plus IB. If I may say this is IC and this is IB. Right? So that is the reason. Yes, guys? RC snubber. So let us say a diode is conducting in this direction and maybe the load current is probably flowing somewhere here. Diode or any other device, I am turning it off. I am turning it off and then I am going to actually allow this current to be carried by something else. You think of a rectifier itself, three-phase rectifier or wherever. I am turning on another device, so one device goes off. So it need not be a diode, it can be a thyristor as well. If I am assuming that this immediately turns off, right? You are going to see that the voltage across this will come literally from zero to whatever is the voltage this blocking. A large voltage that it will be blocking. Because of which, I am going to see that the dV by dt can be very, very high. And I don't want that to happen. So that is the reason why I will put a capacitor. I may have a resistance in the path somewhere, but if it is already the load is regulating the current, then I don't have to worry. I will automatically have this getting charged slowly. But if I am not having the load current flowing through the capacitor, I will need some kind of regulation in the current, which will be given by a resistance. So if I am talking about a current flowing in this direction, then obviously this will be plus and this will be minus. It looks as though the device is forward biased. Normally, the current might have diverted itself in the other direction. It is very much possible because of some other device conducting, which is actually diverting the current in the reverse direction, like what we saw in the inverter, for example. So I will essentially have this capacitance charging at a particular rate, which is either governed by the load current, which is probably a constant value, or it is going to be governed by the regulation that is given by this resistance. So this R and C combination basically makes sure that the capacitance takes a while before it gets charged to the rated value of voltage, which is coming up ultimately across the device. So the device will not have the voltage going from zero to a very large value right away. So the devices are generally given. Whenever you look at any device data sheet, please go to International Rectifiers or Mitsubishi or Fuji or Semicron, any one of the companies, to look at the data sheet of the device. There will be n number of values given. Some of them will be, if it is a thyristor, what is the forward breakover voltage, what is the reverse breakdown voltage, what is the kind of current it can carry, what is the peak current it can carry, what is the RMS current, average current, what is the kind of losses it will incur, because forwards on state resistance, they will give that. And then they will also give what is the kind of dV by dt and di by dt it can withstand. If you go beyond the dV by dt, again it is a destructive damage, complete damage. Similarly, dV by di by dt also, if it goes too large, then it is going to have destructive effect on the device. So all these things are generally given. So when we design a circuit, we have to make sure that all these things are adhered to. Did you guys work out that commutation problem? I don't know. Voltage commutation, what I talked about in the class. I gave one problem. I don't think I gave the solution. In the tutorial sheet, I had uploaded one problem. In fact, even I didn't work out. So I was wondering whether I'll get a feedback that the numbers are not matching or something like that. But I didn't get any feedback. So I don't know whether it was because you guys didn't work out or whether it was all right. I don't know. Huh? Yeah, it doesn't matter. But if you start working out only, you will know. Right? Or I was thinking today you guys will ask, because I don't remember the problem. I just arbitrarily cooked up that problem and then gave it. So I thought if there had been some issue with the numbers, you would have told me. And you guys didn't tell me anything. So you remember the circuit? What we had was something like this, right? There was a main thyristor. There was an auxiliary thyristor. There is something like this. This was the circuit that we had. That's what I remember. Right? And we had a freewheeling diode here. This was a freewheeling diode. And this was the load, whatever be the load. Freewheeling diode will not be there unless there is an RL load. There has to be an inductance. Otherwise, why would I have a freewheeling diode? Right? So this is the kind of circuit that we discussed. So I think I gave some frequency of turning on, turning off. I gave some minimum on time for the device. And then I asked you to design L and C. I think that's what I had asked you to do. This is main thyristor. This is the auxiliary thyristor. This is L. This, let me call it as D1, and this is C. And we said that initial charging we are assuming, maybe through a resistance or whatever. This is the initial charging. I want to charge the capacitor beforehand so that it is ready for the commutation process. This is what we had given. So you know LC oscillation. Generally, pi root LC is the half cycle time, right? This will be the half cycle time for LC oscillation, right? This plays a very, very vital role in this, because once you turn on your M, the moment you turn on M, we said that this is going around like this. The current will go around like this, right? And we are assuming lossless devices. If it is lossless, I'm going to have plus and minus in the opposite sense in the capacitor. So if you actually look at the oscillation, I'm going to have the voltage going like this, right? Whereas my current, if I try to look at it, it will be somewhat like this. This is how the current will be, right? LC oscillation current will be like this. So I should say this is voltage across capacitor, whereas this is current through the capacitor, assuming lossless devices. So this timing is corresponding to pi root LC, because this is half cycle time. So if the capacitance has to reverse its voltage, only then it is ready for commutating the main thyristor when I am firing the auxiliary SCR. Hanish, you don't sleep in the night. So you make use of this class to sleep, huh? So when you are going to fire the auxiliary thyristor, if the main thyristor has to go off, I should have plus here and minus here. And that plus minus would happen only if LC oscillation at least takes place until the half cycle time, right? Because it has started with maybe plus VDC and it will go until minus VDC, right? So it has started from plus VDC and this will go until minus VDC, right? So I should have the main device on at least for pi root LC duration. If the main device is not on for pi root LC duration, the current will not be, you know, really going through the complete half cycle so that the capacitor reverses its charge. And only if the capacitor reverses its charge, I'm going to have that capacitance ready to commutate the thyristor when I am firing A, right? So this pi root LC has to be the minimum time for which M should be on. Minimum time. Of course, it can be on for longer. Nobody is preventing that. So if I say the chopper has, for example, 1 kilohertz frequency, and I want it to be on at least for 10% of that 1 kilohertz frequency time, 10% will correspond to 1 kilohertz is 1 millisecond. So it has to be on at least for 100 microseconds. So I should say 1 millisecond is 100%. I'm talking about 10%. 10% will be, right? I'm going to have basically 100 microseconds. 1 millisecond corresponds to 1000 microseconds. I'm taking 1000 microseconds is 100%. So 10 microseconds, 100 microseconds is going to be 10%. So at least for 10% of duration, if I have to have this on, that means my pi root LC minimum duty ratio or minimum on time I want to have is 100 microsecond, then pi root LC has to be 100 microsecond, right? At least 100 microsecond. Maybe slightly less than 100 microsecond is even better, because I have to make sure that the reversal takes place within that time. So this is one condition. This pi root LC will give me an expression for root of LC together. But how do I segregate L and C? I can always assume some L and say C is the other one. That's fine. But is there any other condition? The second condition is the moment I turn on auxiliary thyristor. So capacitor has reversed its charge, right? So capacitor voltage is reversed. That's what I mean. Capacitor voltage is reversed in pi root LC time. After that, the main SCR is still on for some more time as long as the load is being fed. Now, maybe I want to turn off the supply to the load. So, I need to fire, A is fired when M has to be turned off. Right? This is what we said. The moment you fire A, I am going to have basically, this is my main thyristor, this is my capacitor voltage, which was having plus here and minus here. Auxiliary thyristor has become a short circuit. The moment, so this is A. A has become a short circuit. When A is short circuited, I'm going to have plus here. Please note this plus is applied here and the minus is applied here. So obviously, this thyristor is going to have a huge bout of reverse current trying to flow in the opposite direction. But that large current cannot flow because the device will not allow that kind of a current, so it is going to be quenched. So the load current what you have is flowing in the forward direction. And the reverse current is due to the capacitor. And capacitor does not have a resistance path. It is having literally a short circuit. If at all something is limiting the reverse current, that is only the on-state resistance of the thyristor. There is nothing else, no resistance in the path. So the reverse current can be enormously high. And because the reverse current is high, when you look at the subtraction of the forward current from the reverse current, the net current happens to be reverse, which is not being allowed by the device, so the device just goes off. After the device goes off, the circuit will be somewhat like this. So this is M. M is gone off. Now I'm going to have this as plus, this as minus. This is my auxiliary thyristor, and here is the load. That's it. This is the circuit. Right? Freewheeling diode is there, but freewheeling diode, nobody could care, because currently, this is the least resistance path, so it is going to charge the capacitor. The capacitor voltage was originally like this. Slowly from that, it will come to, so this is old polarity. Now, this is the new polarity. So, slowly the load current will try to reverse the charge across the capacitance from this to this. But in the process, definitely it will go through a zero. Right? So, this is the voltage. Now, it is going to be a linear kind of charging. If I assume that the load current is fairly a constant, maybe RL load with inductance being pretty large, so I'm going to have a linear charging. So, this rate of rise will be corresponding to I load. Right, I load times T, that is what will be the charge accumulated. Right, so I am going to have actually from this point until this point only, I am going to have the device reverse bias. The outgoing device is M. That will be reverse biased only as long as the capacitor voltage is in this polarity. Slowly it is going from this polarity to the upper plate being positive and lower plate being negative. So only from this point until this point, M is reverse biased. After that, M will not be reverse biased anymore because it will have a very nice conducive voltage with anode being positive and cathode being negative. So this time has to be greater than the turn-off time or the recombination time that is required by the device. Right? This is clearly, you know, governed by the equation CV equal to IT. So I can say T equal to C times delta V divided by I. What is delta V? Delta V will go from, this is if I say minus VDC, from minus VDC it will go to zero. That's all. Only until zero it will be reverse biased. The moment it crosses zero, it will be forward biased again. So I should say this delta V corresponds to VDC, right? And I corresponds to I load. If I say I load is fairly constant or approximately a constant, right? So this is going to be, if I say that, for example, there is a 100 volt supply and 10 ohm resistance with the 10 millihenry or 20 millihenry inductance, large enough to make the current fairly constant. So 10 ohm resistance and 100 volt supply, 10 ampere could be the maximum current, nothing more than that. So I load could be only 10 ampere, not more than that. So 10 ampere, for 10 ampere, I can calculate capacitance value. Delta T will now correspond to the turn off time. This has to be, you know, slightly greater than turn off time of the device. So I have two equations and two unknowns, L and C. So I should be able to solve for both. So one is dependent upon the reverse biasing time of the main thyristor, which is going off. And the other one is depending upon the pi root LC, which is the half cycle time of the LC circuit. Any questions on this? Is this clear? So I don't know whether the numbers match. You guys have to calculate and tell me because I have not really sat and calculated. I just gave a problem just like that. So any further questions? Are you guys clear with all the waveforms? Single phase, three phase? Huh. If I am connecting that to VDC through the resistance initially, right, the current will cease to go through the capacitor after it reaches VDC. If I assume R and L, the voltage can be more than VDC. Right? Because the inductance will try to, you know, make the current run for longer. If I assume that the load, this is not I load, I'm talking about the slope of this is I load. Slope is I load. I'm talking about basically the charge accumulation will be linear in the capacitor. If I assume that the load current is fairly a constant. The load current is fairly a constant. Then I will have the current going through the load will be charging the capacitor. So is this mentioned in the question? I hope so that I have mentioned. If I have not mentioned, then it's not. I should say highly inductive load with a resistance component of so and so. If I say highly inductive load, it is given that the load current is devoid of ripple. it will not have ripples. The ripples can be neglected. And in most of the motors and other things, we do have the current oscillating very slightly, because we will try to make the frequency of the chopper quite high that it will not have sufficient time to come down and go up. So it will just go through like this, very, very small oscillations. That's the reason. We will anyway look at choppers also. So everywhere, machines will creep in a little bit, not too much, but. Any other questions? So you guys are thorough with now freewheeling diodes for rectifier operation, with freewheeling diode, without freewheeling diode, how things function, semi-controlled, single phase fully controlled, uncontrolled, right? That's it? Yes. Wide pulse? Yeah, if, let us say, now why wide pulse is needed for triggering an SER? Right? That's what you are asking. So let us say I have a single phase fully controlled rectifier with the resistance and a battery. So current may not be continuous if I am talking about a large battery voltage. Maybe I am talking about a 230 volt supply, AC supply, and the battery is of 220 volts magnitude. So what I have as the voltage is 230 volts RMS, of course. So here what I have is, let us say, a 220 volts battery. So if I am drawing the waveform, I should show it somewhat like this. Right? So this will be about 325 volts. The peak will be 230 multiplied by root 2, which is 325 volts. So I'm talking about 220 volts as the battery voltage. So it may be somewhere here. Right? So if I am choosing some alpha, which is around 30 degrees. 30 degrees will be 325 divided by 2.5. Sine of 30 is 0.5. So I may be actually trying to trigger it somewhere here. This is alpha equal to 30. So I would again try to trigger it here. Right? If the current had been continuous, here the device will get triggered. Not a problem, because only the supply voltage will matter. But if the current had not been continuous, basically, this will come as the open circuit voltage. No current is flowing. So in the cathode, I'm going to get this plus 220 volts. Right? Because there is no current flowing. It is open circuit. There is no resistance drop, absolutely, because there is no current. So the 220 volts will come here. And I have to look at what is the voltage here. That voltage is 325 divided by 2, because sine 30. That is only around 160, 165 volts, nothing more than that. So obviously this particular device is reverse biased. It is not going to get fired even if I try hard. So how do I give it a chance to conduct? I'll give it a chance to conduct only if I give a wide pulse. So I try to give the pulse starting from here. I say alpha is 30, all right. But if the device is not able to take over, I may start from here and I'll give until this portion. So I give a 180 degree pulse, 180 degree wide pulse to fire this SCR, but I can't give a DC. I told you because pulse transformer is being used, so I do the high frequency anding and so on. Now it will be able to fire at this point. If it is not fired at this point, it will at least fire exactly where the two are meeting with each other. For example, whatever is the 220 volts battery's value and the sinusoidal voltage that is coming in, if they are exactly meeting with each other at that point, at least I will start slowly forward biasing the device. So that device will get fired after this. At this point, it may get fired. So I would like to give it a chance. And for giving it a chance, especially in a battery charging kind of circuit, it may not happen in something else where I will not have any DC voltage which is coming up in the cathode of the device. This will come very clearly even in a DC motor drive. Back EMF is there. So back EMF is definitely going to reverse bias the device if I don't fire it at a larger value of AC voltage, especially without continuous current. When there is discontinuous current, I have to worry about the two values of voltages, which is higher and which is smaller. I have to compare the two. So in this particular case, it will start conducting only from this point. And then it might probably end conduction somewhere here. Possible. Right? And it will repeat itself again. So it may again start conducting from here and so on. This is how the current will. So when I have a battery, things become a little difficult for the devices to get into conduction. You don't require a wide pulse if you are sure that it is going to be continuous conduction. But who will give you assurance? You get my point? See, normally what happens is if it is a 220 volts battery, under completely discharged condition, it may have a value of 208 or 210 volts. And you might design your rectifier in such a way that it will give around 215, 220 volts. So you will put a current limiting resistance normally to make sure that the huge current does not flow through the battery. But you have to limit the value of the current to whatever the battery can withstand. So initially the current will be larger. After it gets charged more and more, from 210 it will go until 220. When it goes very close to 220, the current will become extremely small. When the current is small, it has to be discontinuous because the inductance stored energy will also be minimal. So it can't be continuous. So we generally say there are two modes of battery charging. One will be current, constant current charging, which is initially done when the voltage is very small for the battery, minimum value of voltage, minimum charge condition. Constant voltage charging when it is almost full. So there are two modes of charging we normally adopt in battery. Constant current charging and constant voltage charging. Right? So there is no guarantee that it will be continuous current. It heavily depends upon the state of charge of the battery. What is the charge that is already accumulated in the battery? You don't need, but you are never given a guarantee. His question is, if you are sure that it is continuous current, why do you need 180 degree pulse? But you don't need, agreed. But you are not given any time and assurance. Because you are given a rectifier. You may use it for battery charging, you may use it for DC motor drive, you may use it for nothing. So it depends. So when you design, you generally design for a general case, right? So I don't know whether I have kept an alarm, I thought. Huh. come in. Okay, so I'll see you in the minor test. Right, I will not see you guys on Wednesday. If you have any questions, please feel free to send an email. I'll probably put up the email address of our TA also. I know he also has minors, but at least you can write to him. Don't go and bother him in the hostel, probably. But please write to him and find out if you have any queries, if you are not able to reach me for some reason. Okay? Please return the attendance sheet to me. Thank you.